right, good afternoon. You said the players came back a little bit relaxed after Norwich. Have you had the required intensity since?
Yeah, no, it was just I just felt that we were a little bit too relaxed. Nothing bad or serious or anything like that. But yeah, it was important that we set the tone for the week, and straight away the players said it to themselves and they carried on with it, and it's been a good week.
When you say set the tone, you still clearly feel that you could get dragged into that battle?
Yeah. Or do you feel it's... Yeah, of course. We haven't got enough points to be safe, you know, and it's important that we realise the position that we're in, which I think we do. I think we've got clever lads at the club and intelligent lads, and you know, it was just to really push on to them again, you know, the emphasis that we're not safe and that we've got a job to do and that we have to do it to the best that we can.
What can you tell us about team news? Any players back? Any players out injured?
No, pretty much the same as it's been for the last week, 2 weeks. Everyone's fit now, which is good, which means more problems, but good problems, you know. They're all eager to do well. They're all training very well, pushing each other, and you know, that's what you want. That's what you want. You want that environment where they're all pushing to try and get in that starting 11.
What are you expecting from Hull?
A tough game. I think, people talk about their recent results, but going up there, the way I think overall they've had a good season, a very good season, and probably where people were written them off before the season started, they've proved a lot of people wrong. So we're expecting a very tough game, and you know, they've got experienced players and some good players, so we have to be very wary of that. But we're going to have to match them for, like I've talked about before, the intensity and the will to win the game, which I'm pretty sure that they'll have at their max, and we have to make sure that we match it.
As well as making yourselves mathematically safe, do you see this as a challenge for the players to look ahead the next season and to help prepare for next season for this group of players as well?
Well, I think it's important that we finish the season strong, you know. Like I said, we've still got very much a job to do, but it's not just about getting safe. It's trying to do that as early as possible, which is the ideal situation, but then also push on from there and just finish the season really strong and leave that message, you know, going forward to carry it into the next season.
Can I ask about Ashley Williams? You want him to sign a new contract. Do you expect him to sign a new contract?
Well, I think the club's had that discussion with Ash. I haven't had that discussion with Ash at all either, you know, but talking to Ash and knowing him so well over the years, I think... For me, he epitomises, and along with another, you know, quite a few of the lads, they epitomise what we're all about. You know, they've been on that journey with the club, and, you know, you can have good players coming into the club and, you know, they're here for a season or two seasons, and, you know, they can be very good players and do very well for you. But for someone that's come through it all and experienced it and understands how the club works and what it means, you know, to the people of the city and also to himself, you know, he has an affection for the club. I think you can't have enough of those people about, so... For me, that's why I said it. I said, I think with Ash, I think he's got a year left on his contract. I think at the age he's at now, of course, you have to speak to the player first. I'm just talking from my own perspective and a club's perspective is that, you know, those sort of players are the ones that you want to have within the group that you know that are going to push the way that we work on the other players every single day. So I think that's an important person to have at the club. Plus, he's club captain. He's captain of his country as well. So he's obviously a top player to go along with it, so which helps.
Do you need to sell the future to him?
I don't think you have to sell it to him because he knows what's what, but you have to make players understand the importance that they are to the club, you know, and I think he does understand that, but I think it's important to bring it up in situations like this or when their contracts are coming towards the end that, you know, they realise just how important they are to the club and for the future, as you just said there, and Ash is definitely one of them.
At this stage of the season, teams going for titles, teams fighting relegation, teams qualifying for Europe. How big a role can supporters play? We saw with Norwich and the Clappers. And what sort of role can supporters play at this stage?
I think for both ends, they can be... People often talk about it, and it's a cliche, but they can be your 12th man, you know. I think if you've seen the game on Saturday, they were with us from, you know, from the first minute, Arsenal away. To be fair, they've always been with us, in my experiences here, for the last 10 years. I think along the way, they've educated themselves in terms of the way that we play. And it was tough to start off with. I don't think, even as players, we, you know, certain times where we've been asked to play in areas that we wouldn't normally have played in, you know, we carried on with it and we persevered and carried on. And I think the crowd accepted that, you know, after that initial period. And they've grown with us as a team, you know, and I think they understand the way that we play, the way that we do things at the club. And, you know, to have a group like that of fans is quite unique. You know, I don't think you find many teams throughout world football that really accept good times and bad times, you know, in such a dignified way. And I think they've been massive for us, home and away. I think the support that we have away from home has been tremendous. You know, the amount of numbers that we take, the passion that they show, and we all know the Welsh can sing, so we're definitely up there with the best. So no, I can't speak highly enough of them, and I wouldn't just say that just for the sake of saying it. It's actually the truth, you know.
One of the teams struggling at the bottom, West Brom, have had a very public dressing room spat this week. What have you made of that, and how does that impact on a side fighting relegation?
I think it shows they want to win, and their disappointment, and they obviously have a group there. You know, when these things happen, unfortunately, it tends to be for the right reason, though. You know, I'm not saying that you condone it. You know, you shouldn't be hitting another player, or if that's what happened, or you know, coming into a confrontation, you know, that physically, like. But I think it shows, spats within it that they want to win. You know, they want to get out of this situation. They all want to do it. But the disappointing thing for me is how those things don't stay within the change room. You know, I think it's probably the level that we're at, the amount of coverage. It just worries me more that who's leaking those sort of stories out, you know, which would worry me more than the actual players that are doing what they're doing, because it's just showing that those players want to win. You know, that, to me, that's what it seems like. But it's more the case of, you know, I'd prefer that if those sort of things stay within the confines of the dressing room.
I don't necessarily want
to. Even though you don't.
I don't necessarily want to remind you of this.
You do. You do want to remind me.
Yourself and
Stories.
I mean, how did you turn that around? Can you use that to your advantage in a situation like this?
Yeah, but I've said all along, you know, these things happen. I've witnessed and I've been involved in many spats on a training ground. It's because you want to win. It could be a five-a-side or it could be a six-a-side and you're on the losing team. Someone kicks someone, they have a front up and it's a bit of a argy-bargy, but that's because they want to win, you know, and I think you want that within your group. Okay, if it spills over into something else, I've seen that happen. And obviously as a manager or, you know, as a club, you have to obviously discipline them and make sure that they don't go over the top. But for me, like with me and Chico, it was fine. It blew over within the hour, you know, but then obviously everything that follows is part of it, you know, it's part of the way of the world now that we live in. So I think in terms of players and managers and all this sort of stuff, I think the more you can keep it in-house, the better it is, because really it isn't, most of the time, 99% of the time, it isn't really what it's made out to be, you know.
Thanks very much, man.
No problem. You did want to ask it, don't worry. Yeah, it's good. It was good.
You say that you're not safe. How many more points do you think you need? Because many people will consider last week's win the one that took you past the finishing line.
What do you think 33 points is?
Who knows this season? But
do you think it is?
You tell me.
Would you say it is?
I think there's a chance you'll stay up on 33 because your goal difference is so good.
No, that's fine. No, I don't think so. I think we have to, for me, I want to get a couple more wins at least, you know, to ensure that we're safe. And that's how I feel. You know, I might be wrong, but that's how I feel. But I don't want to just do that. I said to the players, I want to try and win every single game for the rest of the season. If we can't do that, then we make sure we don't lose a game. And that's the mentality we have to have, you know. And it's okay, I can say that after we've had, you know, 4 points in the last two games, but I would have said that anyway, because that would have been what we would have had to do. So it is the way it is, you know. I think, like I said, I want to finish the season strongly. The players want to finish the season strongly. And, you know, they've had a lot of criticism this year for some of the performance, and quite rightly so. And, you know, I think we want to show a message of intent that, you know, to take it forward into the following season, that this, you know, we're a good team, we're a good club. And when people doubt us, this is how we react, you know. So I think that's vitally important in the games left.
Wilfred Bony, past 20 goals now as a striker, which is what all strikers want for the season. Do you feel that he will be a target for other clubs in the summer?
Possibly, but you could say that about a lot of players in every single team. You know, players will come, will go, but with Bony, he's a Swansea player. We want him here. You know, he's an important player for us. You know, we make sure that he knows that. And, you know, I think he's had a very good relationship with the crowd now. And they've warmed to him and really see him as a crowd favourite. And, you know, I think he's enjoying his time here. So as far as that's concerned, you know, we want him here. We want him as part of our future, to build the team around. And, you know, that goes for a number of the players that are here. So, no, I think good players that score goals, especially strikers, people that are scoring goals will always attract interest. That's the way it is. But we've never been a selling club. We don't have to sell. We only ever sold players when it suited us. So I think especially nowadays, we're not in debt. You know, we have money and, you know, okay, it's not the millions and billions that stuff, but we're in a healthy position. So we're in a position then, when you do that, to not be able to just sell players because of the sake of it.
With him, though, is the added complication that he will be on the world stage in the summer?
No, but good too. That's what you want to be. That's what you want your players to be. I don't think you can fear it as a club. I think that's what you want. That's why you're here. You're trying to develop players to be able to perform at World Cups and stuff like that. And if you, the more you have, the better it is for you. Obviously, the better the team you're going to have. So I hope he goes there and does really well. Comes back to us in the summer and confidence behind him, and he has another good season and has a better season than he's had this season.
How good could he get, do you think, Gary?
Oh, I think you can see it. Yeah. As I said, you can go for a number of players that are here. You know, I think you can see the quality they have. It's just about doing it consistently. On a consistent basis, and I suppose this season is probably the first time in a while where we've probably not formed or kept that consistency as a team and as individuals as much as we have in the seasons before. So I think it's obviously the qualities there, all of them, you know, the potential to be top players is all within them. It's just about proving it consistently on a week-to-week basis.
And Wayne Routledge, we're going to speak to you. You're pleased the way he's come on as well?
Well, I just mentioned there the consistency. I think if I look at all the players since my time that I've done it, whatever it is, it's 10 games or whatever it is, he's probably been the most consistent player out of all of them. You know, he's every single week, his effort's been massive. He's played near enough every minute of every game. And it's not just because we've got no one else to do it. It's because he deserves to be on that pitch for that long, you know, because he's performing so well. And he's obviously got himself a few goals. I don't know if it's his highest total for since he started his career. And I think for me, and I've known him for a long time, you know, I've played against him and watched him at other clubs and obviously his time here. And for me, it's probably one of his best periods in professional football, you know. I think, unless you ask him and he tells you different a bit later on. But for me, he's performing at a level that, you know, I know he's got in him. And I think he'll say himself, he could probably get even better. So I think it's really good to see, you know.
Is it outrageous to think that he could still be on a plane to reserve in the summer?
No, it's not outrageous, is it? I think it could be for a number of the players. I've been a bit disappointed in the past where certain players hit a period like Wayne's hitting now and they don't even get considered. You know, they don't even get a mention, which is pretty poor when you think of some of the other players that are getting linked and stuff like that. But I don't think that affects them. That's the way it is. It's not their fault that that's happening. They just have to keep doing what they're doing, and that's all you can do. If you want to get into an international team, you have to perform well, and that's all you can do as a player. So I don't think Wayne has a problem in that sense.
Why would that be, though? Is that because Swansea's down the M4 from London?
Who knows? Probably maybe the scouts or whoever it is don't come this far down. You know, it could be that thing, you know, or the managers of the national teams don't come to Swansea. It's a bit out of the way or something like that. I'd imagine if we were in London or a major city, you know, you'd probably get them easy enough to fly in and just watch a game, you know. I guess that could be part of it, but you'd have to ask those managers and coaches and scouts of the national teams. But as I said, the players, then again, accessibility is, especially in the Premier League, your games are on 24-hour loops. You can watch them from anywhere. You can watch them from your laptop or wherever you want to be. So if you want to see a player, you can easy enough watch him. But all the players have to do is keep performing and hopefully something comes along for them.
They've got a big Wembley occasion next weekend. Some of the Swans players know from last season how a big Wembley occasion a week away can affect things. Do you expect them to have their eye on the ball?
No.
Or rather off the ball on Saturday?
No, I think it's 8 days away from our game, so they have more than enough time to prepare for this game properly and have full focus on this to then prepare for 8 days until that game there in the Cup. So, no, I don't envisage that at all. And that's what our players, a message I've given to the players this week as well as part of it, that we're in for a very tough game. We're in for a team the same position as us, really. And, you know, we'll both be wanting those 3 points badly. So, for me, I think it'll be a good game. You know, I think also with the performance that we play down here, we didn't play too well against them. And, you know, we kind of owe a performance to prove that we're a good team against them.
I'm And the usual question, have you had a chat with Hugh Jenkins yet? It's getting to the point now where surely the chat is going to be soon, isn't it?
I think we've got to keep it to, shall I tell you when I've had that chat? Because you keep asking me that. But
it's what the fans are asking.
Yeah, of course. No, I understand that. I understand that. But I can't do any, I just have to do what I have to do. And I said to you before, if I'm the right person for it and they think I am, then they'll tell me. And I quit. Okay, ideally you'd love to know as soon as possible, wouldn't you? We all would. But, you know, I respect what they say and what they do and the way that they act and deal with things. And, you know, I trust them. So it's entirely up to them. So we'll see what happens.
Because clearly you have to start planning
Beyond
the summer. All clubs start planning now, before now maybe, for next season, don't they?
I've said before, I've done already... do that as a process anyway, because it'd be wrong of me not to do that, and then I'm told that yes, you've got it and I haven't prepared anything. So yeah, of course I'm doing that, but I have to do that. That's the way I think anyway. The chairman knows that I'm doing that, and the board and everyone else, so that's the way I have to do it, and until I'm told otherwise not to. But I'm not even thinking about that. But yeah, I'm preparing for afterwards and for the following season, because it'd be stupid of me not to. Cheers, bro. Can you guarantee it?
Of course I will, absolutely. But I wonder whether then that has to be balanced with a bit of caution, in terms of you could go out to win all of them, but actually what you want to do is make sure you've got the points that you're safe.
Yeah.
In that balance, which weighs heavier for you?
No, you're right, safety, obviously, first. But I don't mean you have to go out and be blasé and try and win every game. Win, you know, it has to be win-win. I want us to win every game, and that's what you take into that game. But if for whatever reason you're not playing well, there's a period like we've been talking about, you're not playing well, is we make sure we don't lose it. You know, we don't make sure we don't lose that game. And that's what it's called game management. That's what I try and preach onto the boys, is that you have to manage games at certain periods where you're playing well and when you're not playing so well. So it's trying to limit the chances of you losing the game, really. So it's easy to say, said and done, but, you know, as a mentality, that's what I want the players to take into every single game remaining for the season. And to finish the season strong, like I've talked about, and I think that's what they want as well. You know, the feeling from them when you speak to them about stuff like this is they want that as well. So you're not just saying something and then behind your back saying, oh, well, he doesn't know what he's talking about, well, that's unrealistic. I think they actually believe that they could do something like that. But of course, if we go out and lose the next game, and you'll be saying, well, what happened to that then? But I just mean as a mentality, you know, I think we need to take that forward. Well, they have to follow the instructions that they're given, and you know, the game plan that we're given. And okay, if it's going great, you maintain it. They might have to change something within the game, but they're clever enough players to understand. You know, I think you have to give them the freedom to express themselves, but they have to do it within the team ethic. You know, and whatever the team set out to do, and the way that we play tactically, they have to realise that is the most important part, but then also give them the freedom, because they are, like you said, individual players at times, to go and express themselves, because that can win you games alone. So it's doing it within the team structure, but making sure that you understand what's asked of you.
I'm not going to ask you, obviously, to highlight any individuals, because that would be unfair, but this is a squad that's come through a fairly up and down season. It's been tumultuous off the pitch, and obviously all the pressure's on it. From your perspective, looking at them, I mean, you obviously knew them as playing colleagues, now looking at them as the boss. Can you see who are the units that are really tight and you feel you could go forward with, and the others perhaps who are feeling that they're going to need to fall by the wayside now? Are you already getting a sort of a perspective of that?
I think initially, of course it's going to be difficult. When I first took it, and I think my training's a lot different, the way I want it done and what I'm asking of them. So it always takes a few... You know, some will get it straight away, some won't, and it takes an initial while to get to it. But I think if you look at the level now in training and you watch it, and I film it every day, so I've filmed it from when I started to now, and I watch it back to understand what I might have missed or something like that. And I think some of the drills that we've done before, and you might tweak them a little bit, but they've done them again since, you can see the improvement in probably the whole squad. You know, I think they've brought into it, and it might take a couple a little bit longer to understand, but I think the way of working and what I'm asking of them, I think generally now pretty much the whole squad has taken that on board and are working like that, which is great. And it always takes a while. You can't just expect someone to change like a light switch overnight. It is a process, but unfortunately the position we're in, you haven't got time to do it to how you probably will want to do it. So it's a case of trying to manage it properly and get them to at least a level that you know that they're all doing more or less what you say. So that's really where we're at as a squad.
And this is, I know, probably very preemptive because obviously you mentioned that you haven't had the conversation yet, but you know there must be some thoughts in your mind if you are going to take the team forward over the summer and then into next season about the sort of conversations you're going to have with some players, players that you've played alongside, might have played alongside for quite some time, and you might have to then deliver some bad news for next season. Have you thought about that yet, about how you will have those sorts of conversations, how difficult or easy they might be?
Yes and no. Not really in terms of into full extent, but yeah, I understand that part of that role will be what you just said there, to tell players that probably been good friends with, or you know, that they might not be here, or you know, that they might not play a bigger part or something, but that's part of it, you know. I knew that, I've known that for a long time, you know, and always thought about it, I suppose, in terms of knowing that I was going to go into coaching and hopefully management one day, that these are the decisions you have to take. But I'm more than willing to do that. It's the part of the game. At the end of the day, they're professional footballers. They should understand parts of the game. The last two, three years, I've had to deal with people having conversations like that with me. So I understand how I had to take it. And okay, I was different. I think I dealt with it pretty well. But you'll never get every player to agree with you. But the bottom line is they have to respect you, you know, and respect what you say to them. And they might not agree with it, but I think, like, I didn't agree with a lot of things that Brendan said to me in terms of when I wasn't playing and this and that, but I respected him because he was honest with me. And I think if I'm honest, which is what my character anyway, I think I promised myself in this position I'd always be honest with the player. So if I'm honest, at least I think at the end of the day he'll respect me, whatever my decision is.
Do you feel that you've got their respect?
I think so. They might tell you different, but no, I think so. I think you can tell by the way they work and the way that they want to do it, you know, and want to progress and take the club forward, and not just for me, but for themselves and for the club as well. But yeah, I think so. I think the majority of the group, and well, you'd hope the whole group respect you, but the ones naturally that aren't playing so much will not like you so much, and then that's the way it is. But I think they all respect me.
Yeah, absolutely. Last two for me. Obviously, Hull away, Chelsea at home. Which of those two is going to be the toughest time?
That's a good one. Can I say both?
No,
is that an easy way out?
Yeah.
No, I do think it's a different game, isn't it? It's two totally different games, two totally different teams doing different things, and the hardest game is the next one, and it is Hull. So for me, it's Hull. Hull's the hardest one, and then I'll say to you next week that Chelsea's the hardest one.
I look forward to that as well. Obviously, you know, it's been well publicised about a certain member of your squad has undergone an image change. Are you worried at all he's going to lose his strength and pace as a result of those scissors being wielded?
No, I think if you lose some weight off your hair, it'll probably make you quicker. So.
Funny enough, that's what he said.
No, fair play to him. I think he's quite enjoys the attention of it all, and he does look a lot different, doesn't he? The boys have given him a little bit of ribbon through the week, but that's good. He's a good character, Chico. You know, he's a good man, and he's a big character within the squad. And he does things like this. He's quite out there sometimes, and some of the stuff that he does, shall I say, if that's a good way to put it. But I think it's good for the squad, you know. It's good for morale. Everyone buys into it. And I think he loves a bit of that, you know, secretly. He loves giving the stick and receiving it. And yeah, I'm not sure about the haircut now, but...
I was going to say, give us your verdict on it.
It's a bit of a... I don't know. It's a bit wham, isn't it? So, no, but I think it suits him. It actually suits him, to be fair. But yeah, it's good. No, it's good.
Thank you.